Our fathers, what have you done during the fascist regime? Have you been a fascist or not? Or have you done a little bit of resistance? So I was very glad that my father was in the resistance. And the interesting thing of our generation is after we lost the war, and all kind of nationalism was banned. And I have never heard the national hymn in the radio till the middle of the 70s, or the flag, or all this kind. And we were very open for all other countries, especially for France, who was our former enemy.
But generally, you know, when we think of Germany, we think about engineering, about their scientific development. So generally, like, did you have to go through any resistance from your family regarding
no,
your career options?
Not at all.
Never.
In the country now, my father took us to the Louvre in Jeu de Paume in Paris. And he supported all kind of arts and creativity with all our brothers. So this was a chance for me.
Yeah, it's a big chance.
They didn't want me to be an engineer, writer or painter. So I got, and one is a sculptor, the other one is a painter and an art teacher in the school in Kassel, and one has died very early, but he was a teacher too, and I am a filmmaker, so we have in our family.
Okay.
Film school in Munich.
Okay.
So this is my my identity card of the film school in Munich. It was in from 73 to 77. It was, for example, this is 76. These are my friends from just look to find my so here I am in an exercise in the film school, in Munich Film School. And I was on the documentary film and television department. For example, this guy is the mayor of Heidelberg now.
Okay.
And a lot of, so you see me with long hair and all the
Fashion of that time.
Jeans and all kind of in the Munich Film School. Of course, we did all with film. And then, after this was, my first film was on Turkish children.
Living in Germany.
Living in Germany. This is our class from the film school. Yeah, some are really good directors now.
Wow.
This is Josef Rödel, this is Walter Harrich, Wolfgang Landgräber, Traudel Kühn, Martina Müller, they are all interesting people. Yeah. But we were really a little bit resistance against the directory of the film school. But the thing was, we work together till tomorrow. Christoph Birkel is one of my directors. I did film the editing of 5 or 6 films with him. This is again Christopher. Just look at that. We lived in this house and we occupied it. And it was half occupied, but then
occupied as in you bought it?
No, we didn't bought it. But there was a chance. There was a left wing rich boy Philipp Remsmein, he bought the house and we lived there in communities. For example, we lived in the in the second floor with five people together for three years.
Okay.
And the interesting thing, we never had any key for the door of the house or for the door of the apartment, because it was so free that no one, we didn't need a key
to go
to go in
inside.
And go out. So this was the student in the 68 period.
The students were living in a house but not paying.
We paid just for ourselves, but
not for the rent.
But to restore all things. And so this was, for example, we painted together all the house new, and here was a shop for biological food.
Oh, okay.
So it was in the end of the 70s, very very early time. So this was.
So this was a normal thing there that the students would not pay.
No,
it was not normal.
But to live together in community with three, four, five people, this was very common in those times.
Okay.
Because the rent was so is so expensive in Munich. You cannot afford it as a student.
Even in 70s.
Even in 70s. Now it's worse, of course.
Yeah.
It's really worse. And you have to pay for a very small apartment with one room, 2,500 euros or more.
Oh.
So it's really crazy. So that's why, and of course, to live together with women and men together, free as you want. Yeah, and there were the complete house was full of communities. Usually three, five people together. And that was a really funny thing. As I had friends from Turkey. And they came, and of course they were a little bit shocked because we were really free there. I lived with two Turkish friends in 1978. They came and we lived in one room for some time, and then they changed it. So it was really
your first interaction with Turks?
Yes. No, my first interaction was because in the film school I showed you, as I did the first film. I get to learn the first Turkish family. And they invited me, and in the 70s I went always in holidays to Turkey, and it was amazing because they were so friendly, and you got someone who invites you to the village or the little
very hospitable.
So we go around, and I got to know a lot of people. Of course, I started to edit Turkish films in the middle of the 80s. And in the 70s, I got the first contacts with Turkish directors. After 15 years of editing with this thing, you know, this is a very important thing. This is a press. And you took the film here, and then you make this.
Oh.
So this is and 60 millimeters. You can just demonstrate it. For example, you put it like this, and then you can cut it here.
Okay.
And with a Scotch band, and you have a picture, and you have sound.
Okay, they are different.
Just a tape.
Okay,
and you cut it a little bit like this, so it's not just you have a small fade dissolve here. If you have this. You have not that very hard thing. You have a small, so you cut it here. So this was my tool, the main tool. And you have, of course, you have this bobbins and things, whatever you.
It was a very hard profession then.
And you use this gland to not to.
To not you hurt your hands and.
Not your the film. If you work with negative, and have to be a little bit. So this was the film school time, and then at in 1994, I started the first film editing with digital on computer.
Okay.
The film you can see, it's this one.
Digital computer.
Digital light works, and we had 4 gigabytes. For the whole film.
Oh, okay.
So it was compressed and a lot of it. It was very difficult. It was 12 weeks we worked on this film to edit it.
Okay. 12 weeks was just editing?
Just editing on computer.
Oh.
The thing was, I have a picture of this. So this was the system called Lightworks.
Mm.
Good system, but of course with 4 gigabytes and in the middle of the 90s, so you have all the tracks and the picture, and it was designed a little bit like a Steinbeck editing table, not just if you ask for my name. In the internet, and you will have some of my films I did, my filmography.
This include Turkish and German.
There are some things, for example, this is a Turkish feature film. This is Yeşim Ustaoğlu's first film. This is Özcan Alper's first film. Then we have, show all. As an editor, I have 36, I have a lot of other films, but this is my credits from, you see, it starts in 80 with a fiction film of Sema Poyraz. Then I have some important documentaries, for example, this is called Amir Asia. Amir Asia is a film on Thailand. Made by Wolf Eckhart Bühler, and for example, the music of Terry Allen is very important. It's a film on the soldiers, American soldiers from the Vietnam War who remained in
Thailand.
So this is a half fiction, and then I had another important fiction film made by Ingemo Engström. It's called Flight North, Escape to the North. It's a novel of Klaus Mann with very important actors. Jukka Pekka Paale, Finnish actor, in German, and Katharina Thalba. Here, so see the, here you have the poster. So this, but mainly I worked on documentary films. For example,
all.
For example, this is an important film.
Moscow.
On Moscow.
This is Moscow.
It's a portrait of 6 people during 1 year.
Huh.
In 94.
It's like
just after the crash of the Soviet Union.
Okay.
And then we did with the same director 19 years later with the same people, one light, but the other people again. As a director, I did a documentary film on on a Greek writer. This is Dido Sotiriou, a very famous woman, and she was born in Turkey in 1912. And then she went to Greece after the First World War, and then she and her family was in the resistance against the Germans during the occupation. So they were very, this is a very interesting picture, for example. This is Dido Sotiriou, a Greek. And this is Panikos Chrysantou. He's from Cyprus, and we did a film, and I produced and edited a film on the history of Cyprus in the 50s and 60 years.
Okay.
And he did a film together with the Turkish and Cypriot director on the history of Cyprus called Our Wall. And this is Fikret Otyan, a very famous journalist and writer in Turkey. And this is Kostas Yanakakos, he's a poet. She is living now in Turkey, a Turkish social worker, the wife of Fikret Okan. She's an artist too. So this is an interesting picture, a very... And I think it was in 92 or 91 in Munich, we invited Dido Sotiriou and Fikret Otyan and Panikos Chrysantou. Yeshimu Saulo. Yani, we did, I did the editing and I did two films for her. And this is the director of another film, this one, Autumn.
This one.
A very successful film. He got a lot of prizes and was in the cinemas. And these are the other films. And I worked on a little bit, not finally. This is the film of Yeshimu Saulo, cartoonist.
In Turkey.
In Turkey. And I did a book on Turkish cartoon. Selected the cartoons in 1980, and I got to know a lot of cartoonists, Turkish cartoonists. And I did, and the tradition of humor and comedy is very strong in Germany, especially in Bavaria. For example, we have this this film. Called Shoe Slapping in Bavaria. Shoe Slapping dance is like this, and you do it like this. And the African, in South Africa, they have this gumbo dance. The gumboots, the miners, they dance with the gumboots. And so the film is about the dance of Bavaria and South Africa and the meeting of musicians. And of course, a little bit political things in it.
Okay.
So this is this was a film I liked, and the work was very funny on this, because you have all these Bavarians, Bavarians with the African, and they play together. So it's really an interesting film. And in the middle of 90, I started, I wrote a theater comedy. It's called Einwohnermüdel.
Turkish. A mix.
Mix. And the program book is this one.
Which looks like a passport.
It looks like a passport. And there was a funny thing. We had a show here, a presentation of this piece in Ankara, and the actor came, and at the customs, they opened the baggage, and hundreds of passports
like this,
and the police, what is this? And he said, you can have one. Just,
yeah,
just. So this is the story of this piece is like this. And he's a German, but it's now the time of computer. And you go and your identity is only in the computer. And one day the computer said, you are not Alois Demel. Your name is Ali Demirel, and you are Turk. And he said, no, I'm German, I'm a real German. And during the whole piece, he started to explain that he is not a Turk, yani he's a German. But it's very to prove who you are, if you can speak the other language, you can do whatever you to prove that you are not a Turk in Germany is really difficult. So at the end, so he has to live all what Turkish people live in Germany, and at the end he said, okay, so I am a Turk. But he comes to the airport, Atatürk airport, and they say, you are not a Turk, you are a German. Your name is not Ali Demirel, your name is Alois Demirel. So this is also funny thing, and it was very successful. 2 years, hundreds of presentations in the theater, performances. So this was one of my funny works. What else? The thing was, and I did workshops in the Middle East Technical University in 92, 93, 94, and the assistants, they said, there's a possibility we can take you if you want to this institute. And I thought a little bit, then I, in 97, I said, I just go to have a look how it is. And I it was very, very good. And I remained now 20 years, you know, yeah, it's 20
yeah.
years. Of,
20 years
work in.
Me too.
Because it was creative and a completely free ambience, yeah. No one asks you what you do, why you do this lesson, all this. And they completely trust me there in the Middle East Technical University. And I could do whatever I wanted. And we did a lot of creative things, a lot of films, editing here, and a project with the students, workshops. A lot of people there has become editors or filmmakers or just other. This is Seyhan Derin, another director of mine. This is Dimitri Spiro, the director of the film festival in Olympia, an old friend of mine. Here's my CV in Greek. This is my wife, and we have a...
And she's Turkish.
She's Turkish. And this is a sentence of Katsantzakis. I hope nothing, I'm not afraid of nothing, I'm free. There a piece of tipota, therefore I'm a tipota in after us. International Documentary Film Festival of Leipzig, with my wife and students and a former friend of mine. A lot of festivals. For example, this was last year in Greece, in Olympia. In the jury, I was the member of the jury. This Pirgos Ameliana International Children's Film Festival. If you work with this one, it's one thing. And if you work with this one, it's another thing. But it's just tools. Yeah, and important is to tell a story. You can tell it with this one, you can tell it with this one. But there, of course, there is one thing. Here you have really work, yeah, and you have something in your hand. Yeah, it's not virtual. You have another relationship to the film. Yeah, and you do not hurt the film easily like this. And in this, yeah, you can flip around and
have
this stamp images in this. So I was educated in this one, and I try to keep my point of view and my behavior like I did it with this one, which means I view my films in real time, in full screen, and so this is the thing. But it's if you can use the tools, then it's important is how to tell the story. And the problem, of course, is in editing. You have a lot of technicians now as editors, and they know all the effects and all the things. But to tell a story, it's another thing. Yeah, and everyone can read and write, but to write a novel, a poem, or a story, it's another thing. So this is, and you have to get a good relationship between the storytelling and the technique. I'm retired. I will retire this year, and I will continue editing, of course.
Okay.
And I will live in the Aegean region, which means partly in Turkey, partly in Greece.
Okay.
We have a house in Ivalik, and another one. I just rented a house in Mytilene. I rent a house. It's really crazy. I rent a house like
in Greece.
In Greece, this is, and I will go there to live there in Greece. This is the owner of the house, and this is the backyard.
It's very traditional.
It's very, it's Konaki.
Yeah.
But not just, and it will be ready this month. This is the house I rented.
Knowing Greek language will also help you.
Yes, and I have to learn 1 year intensively, but, and I understand a lot, and I can read and write, and but new language.
Yeah.
It's not quite new. I can speak and talk and read, but to really understand this is, you know, this from Turkish. I only thought to write a book on editing because I have a lot of experience.
Yeah.
And there's a little university with a department like this, but I think I will retire a little bit.
Okay.
Not always teaching and working. So I'm 68 years old, so I think I have a right to retire a little bit.
Okay. Tamam.
Okay.
Yes, sir. So your suggestion for upcoming filmmakers?
I would suggest every new student to start with documentary.
Okay.
Observing instead of directing, and you observe a little event, a person or a landscape, and then edit it. Then you learn how to tell a story with pictures. And if you do a portrait of an old man or an old woman, and she tells or he tells her life story, you can immediately write a screenplay for a serial and everything. So this, I would really suggest to. Besides, of course, you have to train your looking, your aesthetics. Go to expositions of paintings and art, and read some books, novels. You must have a general aesthetic education. of course, photograph is one thing, but sound and music is important for theater. But I would really suggest to start with documentary, with observing something, someone, and then try to construct a little story with found material, and then you can start to create material. So this is...
Yes, sir. Okay.
Okay, so this is my best student, it's Chico. And she's really, she comes to all my lessons, sitting in the middle of the students to observe my my lessons, my presentation. Well, life needs an editor sometimes. And there are some sayings, for example, Walter Murch, one of the most important editors in Apocalypse Now. And he said, and we are used to see cinema in dreams. And every man in 8 hours of the day is going to the cinema and dreaming. Of course, we know not only. But if you have a dream, and dream has really storytelling, but has surprising jump cuts and all kind of things. So living in a dream, editing your dreams, this is, life needs an editor sometimes. It's interesting.
Okay. Thomas Hujam, thanks a lot for giving us your time and sharing the treasure of your experiences and thoughts. Thank you once again.